Welcome, everyone, and thank you so much for joining us here for this edition of Tech Talks. We're really excited to be talking about generative AI today. My name is Suzanne Seidinger. I lead product marketing for AI and machine learning here at AWS. And I'm joined by Atul Deo, who's the general manager for Amazon Bedrock and is going to share a lot of exciting new updates and details with us on generative AI. And so I really have been thinking a lot about, you know, when it hit me that generative AI was going to be a big, big deal. And for me, that moment came last year during the holiday season when my father asked me about generative AI and AI and this new technology that he was hearing about. And he has never asked me anything with respect to the latest and greatest tech. And I realized, wow, this is really at the cusp of a transformative moment for us in our interaction with this technology. And we'd been talking about it for a while, in fact, using it. But then, you know, this was a moment when I realized, wow, this is going to be much, much bigger. And I'm curious, Atul, when your moment was when you realized, wow, we are really entering a new phase of AI and ML adoption here.
Suzanne, for me, that moment was last year, June, when we had just launched Amazon Code Whisperer in preview. And by that time, I had seen enough number of developers within AWS that had used the service and had seen productivity gains. I was really impressed with how many developers were seeing kind of a large percentage of their code being written by the service. And it was magical.
Incredible. And that magic, you know, is powered by technology that's been around, but that has gone through a real transformative moment here. And I would love you to explain a little bit, what is behind all of this? What is a foundation model? What is a large language model? And how are they powering this latest wave of, of technology?
Susan, as you know, machine learning has been around for a while. In fact, Amazon has been at forefront of innovation with machine learning, and we have been using machine learning for almost more than two decades now at Amazon. We've used that in our fulfillment centers. Alexa uses a lot of machine learning.
These are all models powering all of this technology.
The big difference, though, is that these models in the past were task-specific models. So if I had to do anomaly detection for a particular thing, I would do that. If I had to do classification, sentiment analysis, there would be a separate model for that particular task. What has changed really with foundation models or large language models is that there is one model that has seen a lot of training data. And it is generalizable enough where it can tackle a lot of different problems all at once. That's what makes foundation models or large language models unique. Now, one may ask kind of why am I going back and forth with foundation models or large language models? Essentially, large language models imply that it's only text related, but a lot of these emerging models are able to analyze both text and images in conjunction and sometimes also return different inputs and outputs. So I want to use the term foundation models for this discussion just to make it more broader and inclusive.
Well, and so what are these models powering or making possible? You know, you were talking about, you know, obviously code generation, but what else are they enabling or making possible?
So one of the biggest areas where machine learning has been used in the past a lot, it was for analysis tasks. But with large models, large language models or foundation models, we can now use machine learning for creative tasks. And for generating content, brand new content. Like even for with respect to code, I'm going to go back to the code generation, although you are asking for other examples. The beauty of code generation is that while the machine learning model is generating bits by bits of our tokens of code or lines of code, they are actually generated on the fly. They are not just being pulled from a repository of data that the model was trained upon. So it's actually creating new content. And the same concept applies for things like, hey, the large language models, the foundation models can generate new content, brand new content. You may have heard of, hey, I just want to write a blog on so-and-so topic, and boom, the model comes back with amazing human-like results. So this ability of being able to produce human-like results with a lot of comprehension and understanding of the real world, I think that is what is truly impressive about these models.
Well, and how does that relate to customer experience, for example? Isn't that an area that's going to be completely transformed as
Absolutely.
A result of this?
Absolutely. I think customer, the way we think about it is generative AI or foundation models have the ability to transform customer experiences across almost every service imaginable, right? So think about customer care, for example, mm-hmm. right? Like in the past, you've been interacting with chatbots, but the chatbots tend to understand a few things. They can do a few things well. But as soon as kind of you run into issues, you basically are, you know, I need to talk to a human. Mm-hmm. But now with generative AI or foundation models, these models are more robust, more versatile. They can quickly understand, hey, what is the human actually trying to say? Mm-hmm. And they can make use of internal systems. They can make use of internal data sources and actually help be more helpful than ever before. Mm.
And are there concepts that you think, in addition to foundation models, that are really important for folks to understand? You know, can I just use them? How do I interact with these models?
Right.
What do I need to
do?
So
one of the big paradigm shifts has been in traditional machine learning, the barriers to entry were relatively steeper. Mm. You needed a team of machine learning experts, data scientists, who really understood the concepts of sourcing the right data sets, cleaning them, prepping them, labeling them, and then kind of having access to compute, training the models, continuously improving them. And that happened on a task-by-task basis. Mm. And really, a company, if they had to apply machine learning in 100 different areas, they would need to replicate this setup 100 times. With foundation models, the model is already pre-trained. Someone like an Amazon has already put in the effort to source a lot of data, throw a lot of compute at it, and throw a lot of algorithms at it. And you do the three together, essentially, you get a well-trained foundation model. And that is already ready to go. At that point, you can just throw kind of your request in plain English, which is called as a prompt, and you get responses.
Mm. Well, and so I'm sure you're interacting with a lot of customers. They're asking you a ton of questions, and I'm sure they're asking even more questions about, you know, what this means for their business and how they can start to get going with this technology, right? They're seeing its power, and they want to get started. So what are some of the top questions that they're grappling with respect to leveraging these foundation models?
Right. The first question is, oftentimes, I'll just go through a series of questions,
sure,
right?
Yeah.
The first question is, how easy or difficult is it to use these models, mm. right? Because in the past, they've been used to, as I said, they have to hire machine learning yeah. experts. So our response usually is, you don't have to worry about hiring machine learning experts. Any developer in your company should be able to access this foundation model simply via an API and kind of use it directly or customize it. Mm. The second common question is, can I use these models and use my proprietary data to customize these models? And can I do it in a secure manner? Again, with the way these models are built is they can be used in out-of-the-box kind of fashion, or someone can use their proprietary data to train it incrementally mm-hmm. or adjust it for a particular use case. It's called as fine-tuning. Mm. So they can adapt that model for a particular use case and they're ready to go. And even that process is not very elaborate. Sometimes mm. a company for a particular use case, let's just say summarization. A financial mm-hmm. services company wants to produce an investment research report that is in their particular style and they want to summarize it based on kind of their style, mm-hmm. they can just provide a few small number of input-output pairs, let's just say 20 or 30. And when they do that, the resulting output of the model, the fine-tuned model, it produces results that are in line with what they provided.
And do you imagine customers would use multiple of these models together? Or what do they ask you about that?
So the three vectors, as I like to think about it, is accuracy, latency, and cost. So mm-hmm. these are the typical kind of ways in which we expect customers will pick different models. So mm-hmm. and it's really going to depend upon the specific use case. In certain use cases, customers may be willing to they may need a smaller model with lower latency mm-hmm. and for lower cost. Mm-hmm. In certain cases, they may want to go with the largest model, the most powerful model, and they may want to use it for more complicated use cases, and they may be willing to accept a lower latency.
Mm. Atul, tell me, so what are we doing here at AWS to make all of this possible? How are we building our services? What are we focused on in order to really enable all this great transformative work that you just described?
Suzanne, in April, we announced a service called Amazon Bedrock, which is in preview today. It is the easiest way for developers to use foundation models to build generative AI-based apps. Mm-hmm. And Bedrock provides a ton of choice in terms of various models. Mm-hmm. We have models with leading stuff. They're built by leading startups such as Anthropic, AI21, Stability AI. And also, we have models built by Amazon. Family is called as Titan models. Mm-hmm.
And in addition to making all these model choices available, because as you said, there's all these use cases out there, so you need to have a great deal of choice right. around models, right? What else are we doing as part of this effort to make it really easy? Or what are we focused on when it comes especially to customization, for example?
Right. So as I said, Bedrock provides customization capabilities, mm-hmm. including fine-tuning. Which allows customers to submit a small amount of labeled data mm-hmm. that can be used to adapt a model for their particular use case. For example, in case of stable diffusion, they can upload a certain set of examples, input-output mm-hmm. pairs of how they want the model outputs to be. Mm-hmm. And maybe a customer is using stable diffusion in this case for creating an ad. Mm-hmm. And the company has certain ad formats that they have mm-hmm. Used in the past or leading kind of the best examples of their ads. They can use some of those to kind of then train the model or teach the model as what they want the model to actually do for their specific use case.
So a tool, if they're using, you know, our tools and they're sharing some of these data points to customize the model, is that secure? Is their data going to be secure and private in that process?
So Suzanne, earlier you asked me, hey, what are customers commonly right. asking about? I forgot to say one of the key kind of concerns that customers have is how secure is their data? Mm. Even forget customization. Even when
in
they
general.
Submit the data as their prompts, there is sensitive information. And mm-hmm. we've seen plenty of examples out there where company or employees have submitted some personal or company-specific information that got leaked. Mm-hmm. And that is pretty detrimental for any organization. So with Bedrock, we've taken a very strong stance on data privacy. By default, the service is opt-out, which means the service does not store any data mm-hmm. For training and improving its broader models. So that's number one. Number two, anytime a customer customizes a model, we create essentially a copy of that model, which is private to that customer. Mm. So no data that flows through this customized model is ever shared with any other customer. So that data is, and whatever data is used for fine-tuning or customizing that model is done in a secure manner, and customers can use that in the confines of their VPC or VPC private link.
Mm-hmm. I mean, that's so critical, right, for our customers who are really also, you know, maybe in the same industry. They want to make sure that they're staying differentiated and that their investments accrue to them. And that's part of why it's so important that they're building this within their familiar cloud environment, right? They're not needing to change any of their practices necessarily, right? They can get started pretty easily because they're already familiar with a lot of our services.
All right.
And so in addition to, you know, thinking about how easy it is to build with these foundation models, so Atul, what are the long-term implications from a cost perspective when it comes to scaling these technologies?
Right. So Suzanne, one of the things to note is that when foundation models are trained with a lot of data, they tend to be larger in size, and which means that they are not only expensive to train, but they also tend to be more expensive to run, which means that one has to invest in the right sort of optimizations to make sure inference at scale is cost effective. And specifically on this front, Amazon has been investing a lot in its custom infrastructure development. And in the last few years, we have developed Trainium, which is our machine learning chip optimized for training.
A custom chip,
A custom
yeah.
chip.
Okay.
And Inferentia, which is our custom chip for inference workloads. Mm-hmm. Now, these two chips get us anywhere from 40 to 50% price performance advantage over comparable EC2 instances.
Wow.
And as with all things Amazon, whenever we have a material cost advantage, we like to give pass on those benefits to our customers in form of better prices.
Amazing. And that's something we've been experiencing with Amazon Code Whisperer too, right? Where we're able to think that through and offer benefits
Absolutely.
To all of our users
right.
of applications.
And in fact, I mean, I just for people who may not be familiar with that, Code Whisperer is free for individual users,
which I think is staggering.
It's an amazing value that developers can get right away. Mm.
Well, and like we said, that's one of the benefits is that they can use it right away. There's no reason to wait, right? That productivity benefit,
right.
that gain can be accrued to both an organization and to the individual user right away.
Yeah, it's a service that is generally available today.
Perfect. I mean, I think so in addition to looking at the custom silicon, the infrastructure, we've also been thinking through, you know, how to accelerate all of this and really investing with our partners too, like NVIDIA, and even other additional benefits that come that really can accrue to all of the customers who are dealing with foundation models and LLMs and trying to deploy them at scale. And so, you know, I think to think about, you know, this question of choice that you brought up and flexibility in particular, some of this infrastructure benefits not only the users within Amazon Bedrock, but it also benefits all of our customers, the ones also using our Amazon machine learning portfolio as well, right? And what does that flexibility do, or what else can customers do as a result of that?
Right. So, again, we have been, our plan is to offer customers a range of different options, right? So Code Whisperer is a ready-to-use application for developers. Mm. Bedrock is the easiest way for developers to use foundation models and build generative AI-based apps. Then there is a set of innovative customers who want to actually build foundation models from scratch. Mm. And SageMaker is, as I said earlier, SageMaker is an industry-leading machine learning ops platform. Mm-hmm. And it makes it really easy for customers to build, train, and deploy machine learning models. And the same is true with foundation models.
Yeah.
So we have a lot of innovative companies like Stability AI and LG, who have been building their foundation models on top of SageMaker.
Well, and so, you know, where should our customers get started? You know, what would you recommend that they, you know, take a look at in order to really get going as quickly as possible?
Right. So as I said, Code Whisperer is generally available today. It is free. So I would highly encourage developers to go take a look and start using that service. And second, Bedrock is in preview, and you can go on the Bedrock webpage and sign up for a preview today.
Perfect. I can't wait to see what people start building.
Absolutely.
And I really appreciate the time today, Atul.
Thank you.